Well, I once again put up a poll on my Discord server to determine the creature I should cover for this letter, and the people have spoken. It seems everyone wants me to struggle with this name, Xwixwiyá. Anyway, this was also a choice I included in the poll due to a request, despite the fact that I had no info on it in my books. Truth be told, this was a wild one to research, reminding me of the Hedayosh episode at first, but for an entirely different reason. See, Xwixwiyá is surprisingly not an English word, it is Hakamilam. This is the name by which the most easily accessible wikis mention it, but here's the catch. Somewhere along the line an accent was lost. This is meant to mean underwater fly, but fly in Hakamilam is Xwiyá. A whole new world opened up to me once I searched for Xwixwiyá instead. Turns out there is also an alternative name, Xwixwiyá. The creature was first reported by Oliver Wells in his 1987 book The Chilliwacks and Their Neighbors. In his efforts to record the tales and cultures of people living along the Pacific coast, he met a Skwah man named Albert Louis. Skwah are one of the First Nations of Canada, therefore he could trace his lineage back to times before European influence. This leads one to believe that the Xwixwiyá could potentially be a remnant of older legends, not necessarily a recent invention. The being was also mentioned in a 1999 article by Chad Armand titled Strange Crustacean Folklore. It was published in the second issue of North American Bio 14 Review, but unfortunately I have not been able to hand down a copy I could view for myself. That's technically a lie, as there is no place to download it from. I have found secondary sources that reference it though. These creatures resemble both flies and crabs, although it is not clear whether they possess wings. Their pincers are large relative to their black body and are rather venomous. One pinch is supposedly enough to kill a human, therefore waters where they can be found are to be avoided. Interestingly enough, Albert referred to getting poisoned as the Xwixwiyá getting its black into you, suggesting that the venom itself is black or blackens the affected wound. The underwater flies are said to be about the size of a human finger or larger than a hand. Albert wasn't quite clear on this, so interpretations vary. They can move either by crawling along the bottom or swim close to it. Again, since the wings are not clarified, it is difficult to properly picture this method for locomotion, but crustaceans are known to be capable of either or both. They can be spotted in clear tidal pools or in shallow seawater, but there is no evidence of them from deeper coastal areas. Their range includes the Salish Sea as well as the coastal regions of Haida Gwaii of British Columbia, which is quite a healthy amount of space for such a small being. This is the information we know for certain to originate from Skwah tradition. However, having entered the realm of the internet, as obscure as it is, information on the Xwixwiyá did not stay consistent. Naturally, everything I present from here on out, lacking any sort of citation behind it, should be taken with a massive border of salt. There is a clash between the findings of Oliver Wells and Chad Armand, and information found on online wikis which represent the Xwixwiyá without the accent. According to these accounts, this crab can only be found in inland lakes and rivers, or in other words, freshwater. I'm not exactly sure where this deviation came from, but these short descriptions seem pretty adamant about it, so it is worth noting at the very least. By the way, Chilliwack is spelled with a C. While we are at one of these websites, you might have noticed there is an image here. A photo that appears consistently on numerous such pages. Truth be told, I have absolutely no idea where it came from. Now, we'll get into how real or unreal this creature is, but it is safe to assume that this picture is not it. First off, this does not look like a crab. More a fly for that matter. It's not black either. It looks like some sort of cuttlefish or octopus, but the low resolution makes it impossible to make the details out no matter how far we zoom in. Funny how most cryptid photos seem to share this property. Additionally, we see it swimming close to the surface, whereas Albert specifically claimed they move along the bottom, or at least I assume it is the top. Due to the quality of the image, it may as well be a wool cap dropped onto a frozen over body of water. Being quite the obscure creature with the Hakamilam name, there's not much else I could find. I did contact the British Columbia Folklore Society in hopes of getting a bit more info, but they have not replied at the time of recording this. would be awkward if they do so right after I publish this video. I do actually hope they respond though. Now, there is one more question we have already briefly touched upon. Is this a real animal? Well, yes and no. A crustacean with such a description cannot be venomous, but there are numerous ones that fit the bill otherwise, so let me recount a couple as they include some really interesting ones. The flat porcelain crab is one of the better candidates. While its size may be on the smaller side, it has disproportionately large pincers. Even though it's reddish brown or occasionally blue in color, it is rather dark and could be easily mistaken for black among the pebbles or strolling along the mussels. The second most probable crustacean is the Pacific molecrab. It does not reach the size of a human hand either, and its front legs are not exactly vicious pincers, but it is often quite dark in color and could probably be mistaken for a wingless fly as it swims in coastal waters. The only issue is that it likes to burrow, which the Xwixwiyá does not tend to do. Still, could be a contributor to the myths. One more possibility is the purple shore crab. It is somewhat larger than the previous ones, generally obtaining the human finger length of the Xwixwiyá, and its pincers are relatively impressive. Now, it is called the purple shore crab, not the black shore crab, and I would agree that upon closer inspection it is the advertised color. However, at the distance it can easily be mistaken for an ebony hue. It's not like the Skwah are going to check it up close, not when it could have a deadly venom. As for the really interesting options, there's the umbrella crab, which can also sport a blackish shell, but looks like a weird bug. To dial this appearance to 11, we may also consider the butterfly crab. It genuinely looks like it has massive wings, although the head is on the other end compared to what we'd expect. However, it does have sizable pincers, and some variants are quite dark. It's quite a pretty crab, and an intriguing possibility if nothing else. Most likely all of these and many more animals contributed to the legend, and there is no one crustacean mistaken for the Xwixwiyá. How do I know that for sure? Simple. A hand-sized venomous aquatic arthropod with pincers injecting said venom. There is nothing on this planet that fits this description, and for good reason. Pincers are not exactly designed to puncture. They are meant to grab and take hold of prey or pinch predators, carrying them away. If the goal of the animal is to vaccinate another being with a good dose of death, something pointy, capable of a sudden jabbing motion is far more practical. Just look at scorpions. They sport quite impressive pincers at times, yet they did not evolve to combine the two, instead opting to specialize in both types of implements. Also, here's another issue with stinging pincers. They make using these limbs for eating or grabbing stuff a lot more inefficient. First off, every time they come into contact with the surface, the animal runs the risk of losing valuable venom squirted onto rocks or a piece of meat. Every time they tear their food to smaller pieces, those poison glands could be activated, likely wasting just as much resources as they take in. Now, it is an option to not use such pincers for these purposes, instead saving them for hunting or defense. But they kind of lose the point of being pincers then. A stinger would be far more useful in that case. It needs to be heavily modified to better fit the role, and at that point, are we really talking about pincers anymore? Also, if we consider arthropods of a comparable size with both pincers and venom, scorpions are exclusively terrestrial. Not that they would ever be mistaken for a fly. While water scorpions are not true scorpions, their forelegs are not pincers, and do not have venom either. Where they do inject a digestive liquid into their victims, but that is painful at most for a human, not deadly. Unfortunately, there are no extant animals that would fit the bill. Is such a creature completely impossible though? Alright, here comes the part where I try to construct a realistic version of the Xwixwiyá. Some of you might be sat there thinking,
wow, this will be easy, just redesign a swimming crab.
Not so fast there. The Portunidae family is not native to the area. Even though the European green crab has had established populations in British Columbia, they are not among the species with those little pet legs, so they are not the right choice. Besides, they are unlikely to develop a venomous pinch in the first place. It might seem quite a challenge after having shut down the most obvious possibility, but fortunately there is a handy class of animals called Remipedia, the only known group of venomous crustaceans. While they might not look the part, they are actually relatives of crabs. As such, even though they need significant changes to resemble a crab-fly hybrid, we have an easier time justifying how evolution led them down such a path. But there are other benefits to this as well. First off, they are rather widespread, inhabiting saltwater aquifers around the oceans of the world. Hence, a divergent order in this class could easily move towards tidal pools or shallow water. These little animals are predators too, sporting modified legs that are used for striking at their prey, injecting them with both digestive enzymes and venom. As a rebuttal, you might be thinking,
hang on a second, you said pincers are a bad tool for injecting venom, but you were clearly bullshitting us, why are you lying?
Well, let's take a closer look at those claws. You can clearly see that they are extremely far from a traditional crab weapon, modified to better suit the role it is used for. Because the original pincer would have been suboptimal, just like I said. Definitely a good basis for the Xwixwiyá. It's not all rainbows and sunshine though, mostly because they do not have the capacity to perceive those. Remipedes are blind, relying instead on olfactory nerves. This is the first significant issue we face. Now this problem can be somewhat avoided if we have our future Xwixwiyá specimens diverge from rather early remipedes, ones that have already evolved the venom glands, but their eyes are still salvageable. In this theoretical past, some of these crustaceans move towards more open habitats, for one reason or another. This could be the draw of plentiful prey or lack of significant competitors. Let's just assume that there was some incentive. With less restrictions on suitable size, we could have these animals begin to grow larger and larger, eventually stopping at the finger or hand unit as previously established. However, remipedes have a rather primitive build, with their body lacking significant segmentation. The bigger the animal, the more problems such structural weaknesses may lead to, therefore we need to remedy this. Naturally, looking at these centipede-like animals, you'd not associate them with crabs or flies, so we have to alter their appearance anyway. There is an evolutionary phenomenon called Carsonization that has been coined about a century ago. This describes how convergent evolution often creates crabs. It is simply due to the effectiveness of this body structure, but we should not get too carried away with it. Since we need to create something that can swim or crawl and resemble a fly too, I would rather opt in for a more shrimp-esque design. This unique flavor of remipedes shortens, its segments become more pronounced with a thicker protective chitin layer on the back. The hind limbs retain their paddling function to help in swimming at a stable pace with a relatively low energy consumption. Remipedes are not exactly swift, so this is perfectly in line with their ancestors. However, they face a unique problem. With a larger body and an open habitat, some speed is necessary to hunt effectively. This is why the front legs evolve to be stronger and longer, enabling quick, sudden movements. As they strike, they use their enlarged fangs to puncture the prey, injecting it with a deadly venom. Even if it escapes, which it likely will, these proto-Xwixwiyá can leisurely stroll after them as they die an agonizing death. Since ambushing is likely the most efficient way such an animal could catch its meal, white is not a color that would benefit it. Hence a dark, blackish carapace concealing it among the pebbles and nooks of the tidal pools it resides in is a much better choice. Our realistic Xwixwiyá is shaping up nicely, but is not fly-like enough for my liking. We can easily fix that though. One prominent characteristic of flies is the size of their eyes compared to their head. Most crabs have their eyes sit on stalks and are less pronounced. However, compound eyes are not uncommon, the type also used by the insects in question. Extant remipedes don't have a pronounced peeper, but good eyesight is very useful for an ambush predator. Peacock mantis shrimps, for example, have excellent vision, albeit using a different structure. Increasing the size of these composite optical organs is well justified, I think, and is the way to make them really a cross between flies and crabs. Where they are more shrimp-like, but I don't think that's too big a deal. Crab is not in the name, simply a word used to describe them. Now, given the size, a venom strong enough to kill a person is not out of the question. Since it would likely prey on smaller fish, maybe a few scavenging birds if we are really pushing it, such a powerful weapon is not necessary, but not a hindrance either. Many venomous animals are way more deadly than they need to be, This is often simply due to the fact that it doesn't really set them back to produce the specific toxin they use any more than opting for a different, weaker one. If it does the job efficiently enough, no need to produce something that's exactly as deadly as it needs to be. Hence, skinning a person with a sting of its forelegs is perfectly plausible. Since not much else is specified about the Xwixwiyá, this is about as in-depth as we can go about its realistic version without inventing stuff just for the sake of it. I'd say this is a much preferable version to the photo we have. Also, at least this one actually depicts Xwixwiyá, and I do not claim it to be real. That's it for the episode. Thank you for watching this long. If you'd like to discuss monsters, worldbuilding, or simply wish to partake in a future poll, join my Discord server through the link in the description. Halloween is right around the corner and something special is coming for the occasion, so stay tuned for that. We're also getting closer and closer to 500, unless we've already hit it by the time this releases. But that's also my stone I'd like to celebrate with a little something. Anyway, I hope to see you in the future. Bye!